Magic Tree House, Book Number 40, A Merlin Mission, Eve of the Emperor Penguin. Chapter 1, Smile. Jack was raking leaves on a chilly November afternoon. Geese honked overhead. Smile, said Annie. Annie was pointing her camera at him. No pictures now, he said. Come on, said Annie. Smile. Jack gave her a goofy smile. A real one, said Annie. I'm taking pictures for our family project at school. Jack crossed his eyes and made a smile even goofier. Okay, be that way, said Annie. I'm going into the woods. Good, said Jack. Go. Maybe the treehouse is back, said Annie. You always say that when you want me to stop what I'm doing and do something with you, said Jack. Maybe Teddy and Kathleen are waiting for us, said Annie. Yeah, said Jack. Maybe today's the day they want us to look for a fourth secret of happiness for Merlin, said Annie. Maybe they're going to send us to a super cool place. Good, hope they do. Have fun, said Jack. I want to finish raking these leaves before dark. He glanced up at the late afternoon sky, just in time to see a bright streak of light pass over the Frog Creek woods. Whoa! Jack turned to Annie with a smile. Did you see that? Hold that smile, said Annie as she took Jack's picture. Thanks, perfect. But did you see that? Jack asked. The light going over the woods? Ha ha, said Annie. No, I'm serious. It was a bright light. Wait a second. Jack put down his rake and dashed into the house. Mom, Dad, he shouted. Annie and I are going for a walk, okay? Okay, called their dad. But be home before dark. And wear your scarves and hats, called their mom. We will. Jack grabbed their scarves, their hats, and his backpack from the hall closet and ran back outside. Let's go, he said to Annie. Annie put her camera in her jacket pocket and took off running with Jack. They ran up the sidewalk, crossed the street, and headed into the shadowy Frog Creek woods. They crunched over a carpet of fallen leaves until they came to the tallest tree. The magic tree house was there. Kathleen and Teddy were looking out the window. The two young enchanters were both wearing dark cloaks. Hi, hi, Annie shouted. We were about to come looking for you, said Kathleen. How did you know we were here? I saw the light, said Jack. Climb up, said Teddy. Jack and Annie hurried up the rope ladder. When they climbed inside the treehouse, they hugged Teddy and Kathleen. Is it time to go on another mission? Said Annie. Indeed, said Kathleen. And it is quite urgent now, said Teddy. Merlin is failing quickly, said Kathleen. She blinked back tears. Oh no, said Annie. Morgan wants you to find the final secret of happiness today, said Teddy. And then you must return to Camelot to present all four secrets to Merlin. You remember the first three, do you not? Sure, said Jack. We have three gifts to help us remember. I kept them in my backpack. A poem, a drawing, and a seashell, said Annie. Good, said Teddy. Here is where you will look for the final secret. He took a book from his cloak and handed it to Jack. On the cover was a picture of a volcano surrounded by snow and ice. The title said, The World of Antarctica. Antarctica, said Jack. We studied Antarctica in school. There's hardly anything there. Where would we find a secret of happiness in Antarctica? I do not know, said Kathleen. But Morgan has sent a rhyme to help your search. She handed Annie a slip of parchment. Annie read Morgan's rhyme aloud. For the final secret, you must go to a burning mountain of ice and snow. On wheels by air, then all fall down, till you come to the cave of the ancient crown. Then speed to Camelot by close of day, lest grief take Merlin forever away. Forever away? Said Annie. I fear so, said Teddy. I don't understand, said Jack. The rhyme sounds like we're going to a fantasy world, a place with a burning mountain and a cave of the ancient crown. But Antarctica's a real place, totally real. Aye, Morgan's rhyme is a mystery to me too, said Teddy. But you still have the wand of Dianthus to help you, do you not? Asked Kathleen. Yes, said Jack. But he looked inside his backpack just to make sure. There it was, the gleaming spiraled wand of the unicorn. Good, said Kathleen. And you remember the three rules of the wand? Sure, said Annie. The wand's magic only works if our wish is for the good of others. It only works after we've tried our hardest. And it only works if our wish is five words. Excellent, said Teddy. I wish you guys could come with us, said Jack. We must return to Morgan and try to help Merlin, said Kathleen. But with your courage and intelligence, I know you will be able to find the secret by yourselves. Jack nodded, embarrassed. But Kathleen's words did make him feel more confident. And after you have found it, you must hurry to meet us in Camelot, said Teddy. Just point to the word Camelot on the rhyme for Morgan, and make a wish to go there. Got it, said Annie. Go now, quickly, said Kathleen, and good luck. See you soon, said Annie. Jack took a deep breath, then pointed to the cover of the book. I wish we could go there, he said. The wind started to blow. The tree half started to spin. It spun faster and faster. Then everything was still. Absolutely still. Chapter 2. Lots of ice. Welcome to Antarctica, said Annie. Jack and Danny were bundled in cold weather gear. They both wore snow pants, gloves, boots with spikes, and thick red parkas with hoods. Goggles covered their eyes, and wool masks covered their mouths and noses. A hiker's backpack had replaced Jack's own pack. Jack felt trapped by all the gear. He pulled his mask down under his chin and pushed his goggles onto his forehead. Annie did the same. Their breath made clouds of mist in the freezing air. It's really cold here, said Jack. The wind stung his bare face and made his eyes water, but he kept his mask and goggles off as he looked out the window with Annie. The treehouse was on the ground. It was tucked under the overhang of an ice cliff near the ocean. Icy seawater sparkled in the sunlight. The shore was silent and deserted. It looks totally empty out there, said Jack. I still don't get it. How do we find the cave of the ancient crown here? No king or queen ever ruled Antarctica. In fact, no people ever lived here at all until explorers came in recent times. Let's get started and try to figure it all out, said Annie. Not so fast, said Jack. He pulled off his glove and opened their research book to the first chapter. He read aloud, The continent of Antarctica is the coldest, driest, and windiest place on Earth. Larger in area than the United States, it is a land filled with ice, ice cliffs, icebergs, ice sheets, ice shelves. Okay, lots of ice, said Annie. Got it, let's go. In a minute, Jack kept reading. But Antarctica was not always a land of ice. Eons ago, it was part of a supercontinent scientists have named Gondwana. It had forests, flowers, and many animals, including dinosaurs. But no people ever lived there. See, said Jack. No kings, no queens, no crowns. Yep, let's go, said Annie. But Jack kept reading. Over millions of years, Antarctica broke off from Gondwana and drifted south. Okay, I'm drifting now myself, Jack, said Annie. Bye! She climbed out the window and disappeared from the treehouse. Jack looked back at the book, but before he could read further, he heard Annie whoop with laughter. Oh, wow! Jack, come look! She yelled. What is it? Said Jack, closing the book. You won't believe this, said Annie. You have to come see. Jack put his glove back on and pulled on his backpack. He folded the paper with Morgan's rhyme and put it in his pocket. Then, clutching the research book to his chest, he climbed out the window. Jack followed the sound of Annie's laughter beyond the treehouse. On the frozen seashore was a group of penguins, grown-ups and babies. The grown-ups had orange streaks on their cheeks, puffy white chests, and black wings they held straight by their sides. The babies were fluffy balls of gray fuzz. All the penguins were waddling toward Annie. They rocked from side to side, taking funny little steps. Jack burst out laughing. The big penguins looked like a committee of little men in black suits. The group stopped in front of Annie and squawked at her. "Hi, guys," said Annie. "Glad to meet you." The penguins stared back at her with friendly curiosity. "They're so cool," said Jack. He opened the book and found a picture that looked like the group of penguins around Annie. He read, "Emperor penguins are the tallest and heaviest of the penguins species and are also the most ancient. Over 3 feet tall, grown penguins can weigh up to 90 pounds. Researchers say the penguins' closest ancestors lived 40 million years ago."
40 million years, said Jack. "So what time have we gone back to? 1 million years? 1,000 years ago?
"I don't know," said Annie, "but I'll take a picture of them for my family project. They look like a little family, don't they?" She pulled her camera out of her pocket and aimed it at the penguins. "Smile, everyone." As Annie took the picture, a shadow moved over the ice. The penguins squawked loudly and clustered together. Jack and Annie looked up. The shadow belonged to a giant bird circling above them. The bird was brownish-gray with a long beak. It let out an eerie cry.
"What is that?" Annie asked with alarm.
"I'll look it up," said Jack. He flipped through the pages of their book to find a photo. "Here," he read quickly. "Giant petrels are the vultures of Antarctica. They eat dead birds and animals. Sometimes they even attack young seals and pen..."
"Oh, no!" cried Annie.
Jack looked up. The petrel was driving toward the penguins. It hit the smallest one with a swing and swooped back into the air. The penguin squawked and waddled away from the group. The petrel spread its wide wings and dove again.
"No!" Annie cried.
The petrel swooped away but circled back toward them. Jack dropped the book and scooped up a handful of snow to make a snowball. Before he could throw it, the petrel attacked again. Jack leapt toward the small penguin. He fell on his knees and threw his arms around the fluffy little body. Annie charged at the petrel. "Go, get out of here," she yelled, waving her arms. The petrel cawed, then rose high into the sky and disappeared over the ice cliff. Jack let go of the small penguin and stood up. The penguin peeped and waggled its head at Jack. Jack laughed. "You're welcome," he said. "Now go back to your family. Go." He shooed the penguin back to the group. "All of you guys, back in the water now. You'll be safer there. Go, go." The penguins squawked and flapped their wings as if saying goodbye. Then they waddled across the icy shore, taking quick, tiny steps toward the sea. One after another, they dove between cracks in the ice until they all disappeared.
"Bye, guys," said Annie.
"Honk!"
"What's that?" said Jack.
"Honk!"
"It sounds like some kind of horn," said Annie.
"That's weird," said Jack.
"It's coming from over there," said Annie.
Jack picked up their book and followed Annie up the side of an icy slope. The metal spikes on his boots dug into the ice and kept him from slipping. When he and Annie reached the top, they looked down.
"Oh, man," said Jack. "We haven't gone back in time at all."
Chapter 3. Short Grown-Ups. In the icy fields below the slope were yellow, brown, and green buildings, telephone poles, metal pipes, and storage tanks. Tractors and bulldozers moved along gravel roads. It looked like a small town.
Honk!
The sound came from a red bus with gigantic wheels that was parked nearby.
"What is this place?" asked Annie.
Jack looked in their book and found a photo that looked like the scene below. The caption read, "McMurdo Station." Jack read the paragraph under the photo. "Antarctica has many scientific research stations, representing countries from all over the world. The largest is named McMurdo Station. Researchers live there for weeks or even months at a time."
Honk!
Jack looked up. He saw four people come out of a yellow building and start toward the bus. They were all bundled in red parkas with hoods, goggles, and masks. They carried backpacks and camera bags.
"They must be researchers," said Jack. Let's go talk to them, said Annie. We can't, said Jack. They'll ask why two kids are traveling alone in Antarctica.
Maybe they won't know we're kids, said Annie. If we put our goggles and masks back on, we'll look just like them, only shorter. They'll think we're short grown-ups.
I don't think so, said Jack.
Just then someone jumped off the bus. Hi, folks, a woman shouted to the four researchers. I'm Nancy, your bus driver and guide today. Nancy caught sight of Jack and Annie. She waved her arms at them. Hello, she called. Are you two part of the group going up to the volcano? She pointed toward a mountain looming in the distance. Did you hear that? Jack said to Annie. A volcano! He cupped his gloved hands around his mouth.
Yes, he shouted back in his deepest voice. We're coming!
We are? Annie asked, with surprise. A volcano, get it? Said Jack. A volcano is a burning mountain.
Oh, right, said Annie. Like in the rhyme, the burning mountain. Got it.
Quick, cover up your face, said Jack. Jack and Annie covered their eyes with their goggles and pulled up their face masks. Then they started walking toward the bus.
Try not to talk to anyone unless we have to, Jack said quickly. And if we do, talk in a really deep voice.
No problem, Annie croaked in a really deep voice.
Maybe you shouldn't talk at all, said Jack.
Hurry, Nancy called to them.
Coming, Jack shouted in his deepest voice, and they started running across the snow. By the time Jack and Annie arrived at the bus, everyone but Nancy had climbed aboard.
Good, you made it just in time, Nancy said. Follow me.
She bounded up the steep steps of the red bus and sat in the driver's seat. Without a word, Jack and Annie climbed on after Nancy. Walking down the aisle, Jack glanced at the others in the group. A couple of them nodded and he nodded back. Everyone was hidden behind goggles, ski masks, and bulky parkas. Jack couldn't tell anyone's age or even whether they were male or female.
Jack and Annie sat a few rows behind the others. Jack took off his backpack and put it at his feet.
All set? Nancy asked, looking in the bus mirror. Jack and Annie nodded. Nancy closed the door and started the engine. As the bus's giant wheels moved slowly over the gravel road, Jack looked out the window. The sun shone brightly on the wide, snowy fields. Glittering ice crystals blew in the wind. All the world around them seemed to be sparkling.
How's everyone doing? Nancy called over her shoulder. Are you all happy campers?
Everyone, including Jack and Annie, nodded.
Good. I like travelers who don't complain, Nancy joked.
So far, so good, Jack thought. No one seemed to suspect they were kids.
We have a short ride, said Nancy, but enough time for you all to introduce yourselves to me. I'm Nancy Tyler, and I work here in Antarctica as a guide, a bus driver, and a flight mechanic.
Cool, whispered Annie.
I know you all come from different countries as researchers and journalists, said Nancy.
Start from the front and tell me who you are.
The woman in front pulled down her face mask. I'm Lucy Banks, she said. I'm an American, and I'm a space scientist. I'm writing a paper on the use of robots in the crater of Mount Erebus. Hopefully, this will help our work on Mars someday.
Oh, brother, thought Jack. What can we say? That we're Jack and Annie from Frog Creek, and we've come to Antarctica to find the fourth secret of happiness to save Merlin the magician in Camelot?
Wonderful, Lucy, Nancy said. Antarctica is as similar to Mars as any place you can find on Earth. Next?
Ali Khan, biologist from Turkey, said the man sitting behind Lucy Banks. I'm researching heat-resistant bacteria in the crater of Mount Erebus.
Quick, think, thought Jack.
Very good, said Nancy. Next?
Tony Sars from Sydney, Australia, another man said. I'm a travel writer for the Sydney Morning Herald.
He held up a notebook.
Good, said Nancy.
Yes, thought Jack. He yanked off a glove and pulled his notebook and a pencil out of his backpack.
Kim Lee,
said the woman sitting behind Tony. I'm a photographer for a Korean magazine.
Great, said Nancy.
And my friends in the back?
Without taking off his mask, Jack shouted in a deep voice, Frog Creek Times, USA. He held up his notebook. Story about Antarctica. She's... Annie held up her camera. His photographer, she called in a deep voice.
Excellent, said Nancy. A great group. We'll hear more introductions later. Now, I know you've all heard this before, but I have to tell you again. It is very important to remember the rules here in Antarctica.
Jack opened his notebook and got ready to write down the rules.
Never rush, said Nancy. You should always think about where you're going and what you're doing.
Jack scribbled, Go slow.
Never walk on snow and ice fields alone, said Nancy. In many places beneath the snow, there are deep, hidden cracks in the ice.
Jack wrote, Stay with others, cracks in ice.
And remember, all of Antarctica is a nature preserve, said Nancy. Never, ever touch or disturb the wildlife.
Oops, said Annie.
Jack frowned. We really broke the rules with those penguins, he whispered.
I know, but we won't do it again, Annie whispered back.
Right, said Jack. He wrote down, Never touch wildlife.
Got all that? Nancy asked the group.
Everyone nodded.
Good, said Nancy. I look forward to sharing Antarctica with you today. I know you'll all find some great information and stories.
As the bus rolled along, no one gave Jack and Danny a second to look.
Nancy called us friends, Jack whispered to Annie. The others must think she knows us.
Yeah, and she thinks we're friends with them, said Annie.
We're getting away with this, said Jack. He could hardly believe it.
It reminds me of our last mission, Annie whispered, on the ship with the ocean scientists.
This is better, said Jack. Here everyone's treating us like grown-ups, and I don't feel like throwing up.
And nowadays women get to do really cool stuff, too, like men do, said Annie.
Good point, said Jack. But there's still stuff about our rhyme I don't get.
He pulled the rhyme out of his pocket, and he and Danny read it silently. For the final secret, you must go to a burning mountain of ice and snow. On wheels by air, then all fall down, till you come to the cave of the ancient crown. Then speed to Camelot by close of day, lest grief take Merlin forever away.
See, it sounds like us talking about a magical world, said Jack.
But Antarctica is 100% real. It's filled with scientists.
I know, but some of the rhyme fits, said Annie.
Like you said, the burning mountain of ice and snow is the volcano, Mount Erebus. She pointed out the window of the bus, and there it is. A white mountain loomed in the distance. Ice and snow covered its slopes, and puffs of smoke rose from its peak, drifting into the blue sky.
It's burning all right, said Jack.
And we're on wheels, said Annie.
Yep, said Jack.
He looked at the rhyme again. Okay, burning mountain of ice and snow. On wheels. But then what about by air?
Oh my gosh, said Annie, craning her neck.
What? Said Jack.
Look over there, said Annie.
Chapter 4. Happy Campers. Touching down onto a flat snowy field was an orange and white helicopter. The helicopter had skis on the bottom, so it could land on the ice and snow. The bus came to a stop at the edge of the field.
We must be going to the volcano in a helicopter, said Annie.
By air, just like the rhyme says, said Jack.
Great. Jack had always wanted to fly in a helicopter.
Nancy stood up. For those of you getting off the bus now, please remember, she said. The helicopter blades are extremely dangerous. Always wait for a signal from the pilot before approaching the chopper.
Everyone watched as the spinning blades slowly came to a stop. The pilot waved from the helicopter window.
Okay,
Pete says we can go, said Nancy. Jack put their rhyme back into his pocket. He pulled on his backpack. Then, carrying his notebook and pencil, he filed down the aisle after Annie and the others who had joined them in the helicopter. They all scrambled off the bus into the dazzling sunlight. Jump aboard, said Nancy. Jack and Annie followed the four other adults up the steps of the helicopter and squeezed into a small cabin. Sitting in two rows of seats behind the pilot, everyone buckled their seatbelts. Nancy pulled the door shut and turned the latch. Then she sat next to Pete and put on a set of headphones. Headphones on, everyone. They're under your seats, she said. They'll protect your ears from the chopper noise and also serve as a radio so I can talk to you. Everyone reached under their seats and took out headphones. Jack and Annie pulled off their hoods. Without taking off their goggles or face masks, they placed the headphones over their ears. The thick pads muffled the sounds around them. Jack heard Nancy's voice over the headphones. Testing, 1, 2, 3, can everyone hear me? Everyone nodded. Okay, Pete, take us to Mount Erebus. Pete the pilot started the helicopter. Even with his headphones on, Jack heard the roaring of the engine and the spinning of the blades. He held his breath as the chopper trembled and lifted off the ice and snow. The helicopter shook and tilted. Then it buzzed forward through the blue sky. Annie aimed her camera out the window and took pictures. The Korean photographer did the same, and the Australian journalist scribbled in his notebook. Jack was too excited to take notes now. This is great, he thought. All the words in the rhyme are coming true. As they flew toward the burning mountain of ice and snow, he tried to remember what words came next. He slipped the rhyme out of his pocket and read, "You must go to a burning mountain of ice and snow, on wheels by air, then all fall down." All fall down? Wait a minute, what does that mean? Thought Jack. Does that mean the chopper falls down? Do we fall out of the chopper? As these thoughts swirled through Jack's mind, Annie turned and gave him a thumbs up. Jack didn't want to scare her, so he nodded and shoved the rhyme back into his pocket. He watched anxiously out the window as the chopper approached a bright orange-red circle on top of Mount Erebus. Below is one of the world's most famous lava lakes, said Nancy over the headphones. The chopper hovered motionless over the crater of the volcano. The lava lake bubbled and boiled. That burning lava is miles deep, said Nancy. Its temperature is over 700 degrees Fahrenheit. Can you guys on this side see okay, Pete? Pete tilted the helicopter to one side and then the other. Everyone but Jack oohed and aahed. Kim Lee and Danny took pictures. Go, thought Jack, before we all fall down. Okay, Pete, that's great, said Nancy. Let's land at the lower field camp now. The helicopter tilted upright and began moving down the side of the volcanic mountain. Jack saw a small orange building sticking up from the snow. Colorful snowmobiles were parked near it. Moments later, the chopper touched down onto the slope. It rocked and shuddered, then came to a stop. Whew, thought Jack. They landed without falling from the sky into a burning lava lake. But then what could all fall down in the rhyme mean? Stay seated until the blades come to a complete stop, said Nancy. Everyone remained in their seats with their seatbelts and headphones on. As you know, we'll be driving our snowmobiles up to the summit, said Nancy. Driving a snowmobile can be very dangerous on these steep, icy slopes. Please remember everything you learned in your snowmobile training yesterday. As the others nodded, Annie nodded too. Jack nudged her. They'd never had any training with snowmobiles. Another warning, said Nancy. I know you've also been training this week to prevent altitude sickness, but still, it can be very dangerous, so please let me know if you feel any symptoms. Altitude sickness? Jack wondered. He pulled off his glove again and opened up his backpack. He took out the research book and looked up altitude sickness in the index. He turned to the right page and read,
Altitude sickness, also known as mountain sickness, is caused by a lack of oxygen at great heights. Symptoms include headaches, dizziness, and shortness of breath. Climbers traveling up Mount Erebus train for days by climbing to gradually increasing heights.
Oh no, thought Jack. The spinning of the helicopter blades had come to a stop.
Okay, happy campers, said Nancy. All clear. Before we drive up to the top, we'll gather in the hut.
Nancy opened the helicopter door. Everyone took off their headphones, undid their seatbelts, and followed her down the steps of the chopper. Jack was last as he struggled with putting the research book away, getting his glove back on, and then pulling his pack onto his back.
What took you so long? Annie asked when he got out of the chopper.
Jack just shook his head.
Have a safe trip back to the station, Pete, called Nancy. See you later.
Pete waved from the window. Then the chopper blade started rotating again. The chopper lifted off the ground and thundered away.
Chapter 5. Lava Bombs. Jack didn't feel like a happy camper anymore. Walking through the cold, thin air, he looked at the snowmobiles parked near the hut.
We don't know how to drive snowmobiles, Jack whispered to Annie. We haven't trained for anything, including altitude sickness.
That's okay. If we get in trouble, we can use the wand, said Annie.
No, we can't, said Jack. We can't use the wand just for ourselves. Plus, we haven't tried our hardest yet.
This way, gang, called Nancy. She was ushering everyone into the small orange building. Jack and Annie followed the group inside. The one-room hut had plastic chairs, a small heater, axes, jugs of water, and shelves with boxes of trail mix.
Have a seat and help yourself to some of the best water in the world, Nancy said. It comes from melted glacier ice.
Everyone sat on the plastic chairs. Lucy, Kim, Tony, and Allie poured water into tin cups and lowered their masks to drink. Jack was thirsty, but he shook his head no at Annie. He was afraid for them to show their faces.
Before we take off, I want to warn you again about the snowmobiles, said Nancy. No matter how much training you've had, you must be very careful. On your ride up to the crater, remember to drive sideways, so if the snowmobile slips and rolls over, your leg won't get crushed.
Everyone nodded.
How do you drive sideways? Jack wondered in a panic.
Don't be afraid to go fast and don't lock up the brakes, said Nancy.
Locking your brakes can spell disaster.
And watch out for lava bombs, said Allie, the biologist.
Lava bombs? Jack piped. He quickly cleared his throat and deepened his voice. Excuse me, lava bombs?
Lava that spits from the crater, said Allie.
Spits? Repeated Jack.
Like oatmeal that bubbles and spatters out of the pot, said Lucy, the space scientist.
Except these bombs aren't made of oatmeal, said Allie. They're blobs of fiery, hot liquid rock. Some of them can be as big as a car. They burn deep holes in the ice and snow.
If they hit you, said Tony, chuckling, well, just think about it.
Jack didn't want to think about it.
Seriously, it's pretty neat, said Nancy. For millions of years, hot gas and lava have carved deep, hidden places beneath the surface ice of these slopes, caverns and towers. No one knows all the secrets of Mount Erebus.
Nancy took a last sip of water and put her cup down. Okay, guys, you have a few hours to do your experiments and get your stories. Then Pete will come back for us. Let's go.
As Jack stood up, he almost fell over. The room was spinning. He closed his eyes, but that only made it worse. After the others had filed out the door, Jack sat back down on his chair.
I'll just stay here for a second, he thought, his heart pounding.
You okay? Said Annie, coming back into the hut.
I'm dizzy, said Jack, trying to catch his breath. I think I've got altitude sickness.
I don't feel so great either, said Annie. Try taking off your mask and goggles so you can breathe better.
She helped Jack lift off his mask and goggles. Does that help?
Yeah, a little. Jack took a deep breath. But we need lots of help.
What do you mean? Said Annie.
Help getting over altitude sickness, said Jack. Help driving snowmobiles, help dodging lava bombs, help finding an ancient crown. And what is that, anyway? An ancient crown.
Nancy poked her head back into the hut. What's up, guys? You coming?
Yikes, said Annie.
Jack quickly tried to put his goggles and mask back on, but it was too late.
What are you? Who are you? Nancy sputtered. You're not a journalist. You're a kid.
Don't worry, said Annie in a deep voice. He's my son.
What? Said Nancy.
He is, said Annie. I often take him on my assignments.
You what? Said Nancy.
Annie, give it up, said Jack. We're caught.
Oh, okay, said Annie.
She pushed up her goggles and pulled down her mask. I'm Annie and he's Jack. We're sister and brother.
I'm going to have a heart attack, said Nancy. What are you kids doing here?
We were looking for... Annie stopped.
Jack knew even Annie couldn't explain their mission to save Merlin to Nancy.
This is unbelievable, said Nancy. I've got to get you two back to the station. Your parents must be frantic. I can't believe this.
No, it's our fault. No one will blame you, said Jack.
But Nancy was pulling out a small radio. Come in, Pete, come in. The radio crackled and popped. Then Pete's voice came through. Hear you, Nancy, he said.
Pete, you need to get the chopper back here quick and pick up two of my group. They're just little kids.
Not so little, thought Jack.
Repeat that, Nancy, said Pete.
Two little kids came with the group, Nancy shouted. I didn't know they were kids. Oh, it's too hard to explain. Can you come back right away, please?
Sure thing, said Pete. You head up with the others. I'll pick up the kids.
Thanks. They'll be here at the hut, waiting for you to take them back, said Nancy.
Over and out.